initiatives taken by the NDA government under the leadership of our Prime Minister, Sri Narendra Modi ji. We have with us today the Minister of Science and Technology and Earth Sciences and Environment, Forest and Climate Change, Dr. Harshvardhan ji. He will give you an overview of the highlights of the initiatives taken by his ministry for the last 3 years and also the new initiatives in the offing. I extend a warm welcome to you, sir. My warm welcome to Minister of State, Sri Y.S. Chaudhary ji. I welcome Director General CSIR and Secretary DSIR, Dr. Girish Sahani, Secretary Department of Biotechnology, Dr. K. Vijay Raghavan, Secretary Department of Science and Technology, Dr. Asutosh Sharma, Secretary Earth Sciences, Dr. M. Rajivan. An highlight of today's press conference is that an interesting exhibition regarding new technologies from science and technology in heritage, health and agriculture, etc., has been put up on the first floor of our building. I request you to all please visit the exhibition and have a keen look, and I'm sure you will be inspired to write about it. Today's press conference will go something like this. First, the Honorable Minister will release a compendium on 3 years of achievements of the ministry. Then there will be four brief presentations by the respective departments. I'll tell you as it unfolds. Thereafterwards, we will take questions from you. My request is you please restrict your questions to today's departments and not the Environment Ministry. Any one-to-one interview or more information that you want on the subject, you may please contact our PIB officer, Srimati Ranjana Sharma. She will facilitate your request. And a gentle request to all of you, please follow the points of order when you ask questions. Please raise the placards that are kept in front of you. I will call out the number. And also keep your mobiles on a silent or switch off mode. Now I request the Honorable Ministers to release the book. There are no placards. I think there has been some gap. This side it is there. This is for the media basically. But anyway, we will work out, don't worry. Yeah? I can see your hand. Thank you, Honorable Minister, sirs. Now, first I request Director General CSIR and Secretary DSIR, Dr. Girish Saharini, to make his presentation.
Thank you. Honorable Dr. Harshvardhan ji, Shri Chaudhary ji, my colleagues from the ministry, esteemed dignitaries on the dais, and friends of the press, and ladies and gentlemen, I will take you briefly through 5-6 minutes of some of the outstanding achievements that the Council of Scientific Industrial Research, which is a 75-year-old organization celebrating its platinum jubilee this year. Can I have the first slide? Okay. I don't have a control here, but I guess. Can we? Yeah, this was the float that CSIR did on the Republic Day Parade. Next slide. The focus since the last 3 years has been on creating synergies and taking technology and science to the solution of actual problems in society, using fundamental science or science directed towards potential applications as the leitmotif. So promotion of R&D in such a way that industry gets national competitiveness, innovative technologies, connection to students. CSR happens to be the main organization for senior level fellowships. Significant improvement in fellowship amounts and numbers have taken place in the last 3 years. Next slide, please. We have started very focused programs on mission mode and fast track translational projects, 150 short-term delivery fast-track projects have been launched. I will talk about those briefly. Scientific entrepreneurship is a leitmotif throughout the ministry. We will talk about it a little later. Next slide. CSR labs, 38 in number, are spread all over the country, varying from electronics, biotechnology, drug discovery, aerospace engineering, virtually every aspect of science and technology. The great challenge is to bring them into a synergy mode and not work in silos. That has been done. Very focused programs have started under 8 themes. So instead of having clusters around scientific subjects, which are good for academic research, we have focused on themes, next slide, which are 8 in number: civil structure, civil infrastructure and engineering, mining, minerals, materials, chemicals and petrochemicals, health sector, aerospace and strategic sector. So virtually 8 labs have started working together very closely on national problems and strategic areas. Now this is the same plan as all the departments have in the Science and Technology Ministry, have started creating a very strong synergy focused towards themes and delivery of actual solutions. This was goaded by and inspired by the president of CSR and the prime minister of the country, Shri Narendra Modi, who said, start working on problems of the poorest of the poor and the industry, use science for the benefit of the people. That activation, although it was the mandate of CSR, it has always been, it has gained a renewed vigor. Next slide, please. One of the main initiatives that has been launched last year has been the skill development program of CSR, where something like 35 new courses have been launched. Another 40 will be launched this year and the next. This 75 odd programs basically are focused towards creating higher level of skill in people so that they can be absorbed by industry. This is a program that was launched a few months ago and it has already taken off and students have started getting into these courses. Next slide, please. I will now enumerate some outstanding achievements of this council. Next slide. CSR happens to be the 12th organization in the whole world amongst publicly supported R&D organizations, where not only publications but patents and media connectivity through its stakeholders, media perception, are some of the criteria. And CSR is the 12th amongst virtually 1,200 organizations and 99th, only the Indian organization in the Simago ratings, amongst nearly 5,500 organizations throughout the world. Next slide. If you look at, we did a program a couple of years ago, where we said, what is the value created from our technologies? You can get royalty, you can actually make industry earn profits, but at the end of the day, what is the value or socio-economic impact created from technologies across society? We took up just 6 technologies, a clodbuster, a tractor, etc., which are enumerated there, and we calculated that the total direct value creation was more than 30,000 crores. And this is more than the combined budget in the last several decades of this council, of the organization. Next slide. So what this shows is that our technologies have made an impact. Now we are doing it for several technologies that we are launching and that we launched very recently. And the input that comes out is very of tremendous contribution to society. One particular success story has been the clodbuster, started out as a CSR DBT initiative early on. It has supplied the much needed clodbusters needed for heart patients. Virtually all the clodbusters in the country are from, 50% of the clodbusters in the country are from this technology, and it has led on to novel third generation and fourth generation clodbusters, which are licensed out to foreign companies also for multi-million dollar deals. Next slide. We have the example of Saheli, a world-class, first non-steroidal contraceptive, which has been taken up by the family planning program last year. It has major societal impact, And this is a great success story. Next slide. Most of these details are in the booklet that has been given to you. And I will just touch very briefly. This is another success story that represents an Ayurvedic drug which came out of two CSR labs, CMAP and NBRI. And this drug is selling virtually like hotcakes, but it takes care of the bad effects of hotcakes in the sense that it fights diabetes. And it has been a success story. In the few months that has been in the market, more than 100 crore value of this drug has been sold. And it is a harbinger also of a series of Ayurvedic drugs which the council has launched with the help of NRDC. Several drugs are in the market which have gone through clinical trials and rigorous testing, and they are actually competing with allopathic drugs. Next slide. This is another great success story from the CSR stable, which is high quality US grade gasoline, and which also produces pure benzene from refineries, and it has been licensed to Reliance, and it is now in the process of dissemination worldwide. It has already started functioning in their plant. Next slide. CSR contributed tremendously to strategic sector, and in the LCA also, the Tejas and the light combat aircraft, a lot of contributions went. Recently we did a socio-economic or rather an impact study. We found out that our contributions represent about 5,000 crores of contribution, because the replacement value of this, you know, how much country would have gained by producing a world-class fighter, goes into the algorithm of that socio-economic impact study. Next slide. Next. Again, the head-up display, which is a captive technology of a few countries, India is one of those six countries which has head-up display for fighter aircraft, went into the LCA, and it's all its succeeding generations. This is a great success story of a lab in Chandigarh, CSIO. Next slide. A few months ago, Honorable Minister Dr. Harshvardhan unveiled and launched a solar tree, which has the potential of, which actually with a very small footprint, 10 times less than the regular sprawled out solar panels. This is a tree on which several panels are decorated to save space, and it is quite affordable. We are entering into production now. Already it's under production, and it can be a great model for dissemination across the country to capture sunlight for electricity. Next slide. We have also a big program on lithium batteries in Karaikudi, which complements very well with the renewable energy initiative. Next slide. This is another initiative that was launched last year. It's a great success story already. Nearly 200 of these machines have been bought by dairies all across the country. It is a rapid 1 minute, less than 1 minute, you can test the quality of milk and do almost 15 to 20 analytical outputs you get, including synthetic milk, which is a grave problem in our society. And this is now been converted, next slide, into handheld, much more affordable unit, which we hope that will transform dairy milk testing, etc., and the adulteration problem. Next slide. This is another great impactful story. Last year, this is again a synergy between DBT and CSR, and labs in CSR, CCMB particularly, where new varieties of Sama Musuri, the very popular high-quality rice, which is resistant against bacterial blight, has been released. Nearly 100,000 hectares are under cultivation now. It's major impact. And newer varieties of rice, for example, arsenic rice that if it's grown in arsenic abundant soils will not give you grain that is abundant in arsenic. So it's safe to consume. That rice has been released in Bengal. That has also been developed by CSR Labs. Next slide. This is another great initiative that has the potential to augment farm income by nearly twofold, the dream and the inspiration given by Prime Minister. Here, aromatic plants which give high-value oils, etc., have been distributed in Jammu and Kashmir and for several thousand farmers. And the whole value chain of not only planting material, but the final oil output has been, this technology gives that. Next slide. Now we have converted into a major aroma mission. And the impact here, I will not take you because of paucity of time, but total area brought under cultivation with these aromatic plants is nearly 400,000. Next slide. And this is another very potentially impactful technology. basically information technology and sensor-based technology, where Delhi Metro had this system implanted, and it gives something like a 10 to 15 second advantageous forewarning to the metro control unit of earthquake. So that in the 10 or 15 seconds, you can actually halt the hundreds of metros, the metro lines, the trains going on the metro lines, so that there is no major disaster. It's been a success. This is first of its kind in the country. Very few countries in the world, particularly Japan, have and introduced this. So this is something that we need to upscale. Next slide. This is an initiative launched very recently in hand in hand with the Power Ministry, where the quality of coal which comes out of our coal mines is monitored and checked by one of our labs, SIMFER, in Dhanbad, which actually creates the caloric value of coal so that it is rated and it is economically rated correctly, and it leads to a lot of saving for the power companies, and it is passed on to the consumer. Next slide. Next slide, please. Nearly 150 fast-track translation projects have been launched, which have started giving outcomes and outputs. In the next 2 years, we hope to get at least 70 to 80. Trace it on a newspaper or a printed sheet. It will speak out the material so that anybody who's illiterate or blind can also can hear it. Next slide. Waterless tanning technology, a great advantage, where traditional tanneries used to pollute a lot of water. This is another internationally viable breakthrough, where the Leather Research Institution in Chennai has come up with waterless chrome training technology, and it does not pollute water. It is very, basically dry technology. Next slide. This is another technology which lets you predict the pregnancy and the gestation period in animals, which is of great significance in the agriculture sector. Next slide. As I said, a CSR aroma mission has been launched throughout the country. We believe that this will make a major transnational impact, because you could potentially take the right varieties and grow them at their right places. In fact, you can mold and breed new aroma plants, which can be grown in areas which are traditionally not their native soils. This is a major program we have launched. Next slide. Similarly, this program and a similar program on phytopharmaceuticals is an ambitious program, where we will create the Ayurvedic varieties which can be grown reproducibly and which will give you reproducible medicines, which is a very great gap in the Ayurvedic industry. Most of the plants are plucked out from the wild and they give you very variable outcomes. This is a major program CSR has launched, where virtually about 30 major Ayurvedic plants, which are most often used, their traditional plants of standardized material will be grown. This, we want to extend it to other countries as well, because the demand for Ayurveda high quality steel, which is required for transformers, which is not present in the country. Its technology is only with very few countries. We have filed patents, and we are going forward hand in hand with the steel ministry to start production of this eventually. Next slide. So this is just a glimpse and overview of the focus into creating public goods, private goods. Public goods means publications and patents, private goods for industry, social goods, where, for example, plant varieties, and strategic goods for the strategic sector, including patents that will produce new technology. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for your patience.
Thank you, Dr. Girish Sahani ji. Secretary, Department of Biotechnology, will now give a presentation. Dr. K. Vijay Raghavan.
Good afternoon, everybody. I will make a presentation on the Department of Biotechnology's work in the last 3 years. The key areas of our focus range from policy, R&D, human resources, international collaborations, the Northeast, innovation, and enterprise. Could you go to the next slide, please? I will. So these are the key areas we are looking at. The next slide, I will tell you very briefly what we are doing on the policy initiatives. We have a National Biotechnology Development Strategy document, 2015 to 2020, which was released by the Honorable Minister, and this is the fulcrum on which all our work is based on. And all of what I'll talk to you about is based on that strategy document. We very recently had the Regional Center for Biotechnology Bill passed in Parliament, and the RCB is an institution now which reaches out to every corner of the country, is developing programs from degree courses, certification courses, diplomas, all over the country. But as a UNESCO institution funded by the Government of India, it also will cater to countries in the SAARC region as well as Southeast Asian region. So that's a major new program. Now, I will go through specific major missions of the government. Swasth Bharat is the first, and we have many different programs. In stem cell research, for example, we have made major advances in using new techniques for sickle cell anemia and also for thalassemia. That is making good progress. In herbal drugs, a major program on multi-institutional preterm birth, and in biodesign, we have had many new devices and technologies which have been licensed and commercialized. But I will address two major advances here. The first, in the next slide, is a major new biopharma mission which the cabinet just cleared last week. And this is a 1,500 crore mission which will develop cutting-edge capabilities in vaccines, drug discovery, and medtech, bridging the gap between academia and industry and allowing Indian industry, which is now a global leader in delivery, to also become a global leader in innovation and discovery all the way down to delivery. The next slide addresses another major challenge, of which vaccines is a major part of the answer. Epidemics such as Ebola, Zika strike anywhere and can hit countries such as India very badly. Yet dealing with them is hugely expensive, requires multi-billion dollars in each place, and there's what is called a market failure gap in this. Companies will not take up this area anywhere in the world. And therefore, we are partnering in a major global program, which India is the leader, India is the chair of the program, to have a common support for bridging this gap for emerging epidemics, and also will result in a major thrust in Indian vaccine development for diseases which we have no vaccine capability now. We now go on to another aspect which is very critical, Krishi Vigyan, and we have several new programs there. But fundamentally, one area which we have made major impact and advance is in nutrition, in adding nutrients to meals. And this is a program which in our eastern states, we have partnered with the state governments to have nutrients in rice, for example, shown in this photograph, which are delivered to school programs in partnership with different state governments in the eastern region. But I will then now tell you about a couple of programs which in this area which have made significant progress. One is the next slide. Tells us about a new program called Krishi Innovation Science Application Network, or KISAN. Here, we take implementation of available science and technologies to the farmers, partnering with NGOs, with state agriculture extensions, with tinkering laboratories, farmers' organizations, to actually solve specific problems in each of the agroclimatic zones. We have already sanctioned funds for 7 agroclimatic zones, and we are going to expand this and have this network very robust. A very important feature of this is women farmers, fellowship for women farmers, and reducing the drudgery and making them the agents of change in the farm sector. At the other end of the spectrum, next slide, at the high-tech level, we have partnered globally to sequence the wheat genome and done the chickpea genome ourselves, and these have resulted in new wheat strains being developed, new chickpea high-yielding lines which have been obtained, and field trials for this are going on. We go on now from the products which we generate and using waste from those products, next slide please, to generate energy. And we have many programs here. Decentralized wastewater treatment for crops is something which has worked out very well as part of a global collaboration in the Telangana region. We have had factory effluents being cleaned up and used for crops there. And sanitation, we have had major new technologies in reinventing the toilet, which are now in the test phase and are being scaled up. And we have got commercialization of technologies from clean energy to agricultural waste is a very major achievement at Kashipur. A test plant has now been scaled up, is being scaled up in collaboration with oil manufacturing companies, and they have taken up to have major programs from waste to energy. Mission Innovation is a program which has clean energy research doubling as its aim, And the Department of Biotechnology is leading this program in partnership with other ministries in the Government of India to make sure that our clean energy program research doubles hugely. I will focus on, I'll tell you a little bit about two programs. The next slide is the applying biotech to clean flowing sewage, which is a major, major challenge. And we have got new technologies here which are being tested out now. And in 2 years, we'll have a larger scale pilot plant, and we hope to have it scaled up, if that is successful, on a much larger scale. This is at Barapula in the Delhi region. Now, we go on the next slide to human resource development. And this is really the fundamental aspect, the foundation of everything we do. Because if you are to be prepared for the challenges of today, we need people. But if you are to be prepared for unknown challenges about which you have no idea, then again, people is the main focus. And therefore, our Star College scheme is a major thrust for getting life sciences-based learning into all of science departments all over the country. I'll tell you a little more about it. But our BioCare scheme, for example, gets women back to science careers. And we've got major international partnerships, such as with the European Molecular Biology Organization, which gives our scientists quality facilities anywhere in the world. Smart Hackathon is a program which was launched in partnership with AICTE and the MHRD, and this resulted in lakhs of students from all over the country coming in to hack major problems. And we have re-entry fellowships, which bring scientists from all over the world back to India, Indians back to India, and also programs for Indian scientists here. So the next slide shows you the Star College scheme, which has reached every single corner of the country, and we are expanding this in a significant manner. We are very, very stringent on the standards, so only a significant small fraction of the applications received get funded as strengthening, and 26 Star Colleges have got a very high ranking, but these have laboratories, teaching, have teachers from all over the country and the world coming in, and this is a very important program which stimulates young people. The next slide illustrates on the left-hand side Mahatma Gandhi looking through a microscope, and at a meeting in Trivandrum many years ago he said, we must go out of our ivory towers and have citizen science and take science to our citizens. The foldscope shown on the right-hand side is an invention of Manu Prakash from Bareilly, who studied in IIT Kanpur, became a professor at Stanford, and has created this origami microscope, which is actually very high-tech but costs only $1. 100,000 of these microscopes will now be distributed in training camps all over the country this year, and this will be a major citizen science effort, but also of great value to health and agriculture. I now go on the next slide to international collaboration. If you have to succeed speedily and with quality, we must partner with the best in the world. The Prime Minister has said, science is global, but technology must be applied locally. And that's exactly what we're doing. We have major collaborator programs with every country which has got a major science footprint. And for example, with Finland, we've got collaborations in cancer, in medtech devices, with Sweden, with Japan in stem cells, with the US on vaccine programs, with the UK on agriculture and biotechnology. We brought 9 Nobel laureates to the country, and they went all over the country, and there was a major exhibition. I'll tell you a little bit about that in the next slide, where a Nobel exhibition, the Nobel Museum exhibition, came to Gujarat last year. Early next year, it'll be in Goa. These 9 Nobel laureates participated in a major symposium, and over 3 lakh students came to the exhibition, and the Nobel laureates went all over the country and gave talks. And this is a program which will happen every year, and this is really stimulating young people to come into science. 10%, the next slide, of our budget, 10% of our budget goes to the Northeast, and we're very proud of that, and we have hugely enhanced our Northeast programs. The Center for Advanced Animal Diagnostics, for example, has been set up, and that is working on diseases of the Northeast for animal diseases in that area. That's had a huge impact. We've had a unit of excellence in biotechnology for mid-career scientists, and 12 of them have been set up. And biotechnology labs in senior secondary schools in the Northeast have been established in 88 schools. Just 3 days ago, teachers from all these schools came to Delhi for a meeting, went to multiple labs here, and they're an extraordinarily driven lot, and they're changing the face of science education in the Northeast. Some of the pictures show our work on centered rice and on agriculture in the Northeast. The next slide, I will address two points, but first to say we have an overseas research associateship program for scientists for capacity building in cutting edge areas, and more than 110 scientists have availed of this and gone abroad from the Northeast and come back. The next slide shows that we have got 21 healthcare laboratories in the Northeast, These are working closely with the health system in the Northeast so that the diagnosis of diseases, but also a research understanding of what the problems are and how to solve them takes place. And this has been established with medical collaborations in the Northeast region. The next slide shows our major thrust in what we call twinning programs. Laboratories and institutions and investigators in the Northeast partner with similar people all over the country, and as you can see, the link goes every part of the country. A major chemical ecology program, for example, has been started to understand the relationship between insects and plants and what's the chemistry. This has major possibilities in drug discovery and in conservation, and these are the kinds of programs which are scaling up. A new program has just started on taxonomy in Sikkim to document all the plant varieties in the multiple agroclimatic zones which are there in Sikkim. And this is a major thrust. Now, I'd like to end by saying that that startup is a major theme which India has. The Biotechnology Research Assistant Council, or BIRAC, whose exhibits you see outside, has been catapulting Indian biotech to a completely new level. There are about 636 projects supported, two regional entrepreneurship centers, 96 academic institutes, 350 startups, 397 companies, 120 IPs generated, and so on. And this kind of a setup has worked enormously well because BIRAC has its tentacles into the academic ecosystem on one hand and partners with industry on one hand to bridge the gap to make sure that all the fruits of our research are translated. Next slide, please. I'd like to thank you very much, and this has been a very exciting time for the Department of Biotechnology, and we look forward to doing more.
Thank you, Dr. Vijayaraghavan. Now I request Dr. Asutosh Sharma, Secretary, Department of Science and Technology, to give his presentation.
Department of Science and Technology has very wide mandate. Seeding and sustaining science, technology, and innovation in all its forms across all their stakeholder base, going from a school to universities to IITs to ICERs to R&D labs of all kinds. So the mandate indeed is very, very wide. DST does everything that DBT secretary had talked about, but also outside of biotechnology areas, so including all the forms of science, technology, and innovation. So I'm very glad to report that our budget, which is now 4,837 crores, has grown nearly double starting from 2014 and 15, because of which we are able to launch several new programs, strengthen programs that mesh with our scientific national priorities to give a new boost to the aspiration of the society. Since there are very large number of programs from grassroots to very advanced science, I would not be able to talk about all of them. So I would focus actually on what has been happening in last 2 years, mostly the new programs, and also the achievements arising from these programs in the last 2 years. I would not be able to get into details, so if you have interest in learning more about any of these programs, I'm going to hang around here for another 1 hour or so, be very happy to interact. What are the major new directions? Well, of course, we have to strengthen our quality science, and the number of scientists, because these are the people who contribute to our PSUs, to our strategic missions, to our universities, to the competitiveness of our industry. We align our science and technology to solve problems. There are problems in water, energy, environment, transport, all the stuff, Digital India, and so on. There's greater push on doing quality science, but also translating that into technology, into innovation, into startup. There's a whole new movement which has been put in place. And then connecting our R&D and innovation to society in a very strong way, connecting it to education, to line ministries, to grassroots, NGOs, and industry. Okay, so let's just first take up the startup program. There are two new programs. The first one reaches out to grassroots, to our students from class 6 to class 12. And idea is to reach out to 5 lakh schools to generate top 1 million ideas or 10 lakh ideas from the school, then to mentor these students into innovation, converting idea into prototypes, and up the value chain, starting from district level, state level, national level. A huge program which would strengthen at the grassroots the gospel of innovation. This is going to produce large number of innovators in the years to come. The second program, Nidhi, is basically recognizes the fact that innovation is not a single event, but you need to strengthen the entire value chain from awareness building to scouting, mentoring, training, prototyping, fellowships, seed funding, accelerating, making new incubators, making new research parks. And our objective is that we would double the size of technology-led innovation ecosystem in the next 4 years, which means what has happened in the last 30 years, we would double the size of that in the next 4 years. So it's a very strong program, but also not just making incubators, but making sure that the startups succeed. For a startup to succeed, we need a whole lot of enabling factors. Just to give one example, these are stuff that's coming out of a single incubator, right? There are 100 of these incubators. We made 25 new incubators just last year. What that means is, you know, just look at a single incubator and so many nice products which are coming out from there. The number of these examples would run into thousands. So you can't really capture all of that. In fact, each one of these would make a nice story. In fact, most of the stories that we pen and that we read in newspapers and TV every day, there is some involvement of Department of Science and Technology in supporting that story. So just to give an example, that there are actually tens of thousands of these stories spread all over in the domain of science and technology. Okay, another major challenge is we want to retain the best of our scientists in India. At the same time, we also want to bring the best of world to India. A very huge, very strong program that we are launching this year is called Vajra Faculty Scheme. This would bring into India the best of scientists and professors from abroad. So they set up shop here. It's not simply visiting, giving few lectures and going away. They are going to set shop here. They are going to train our PhD students. They are going to spend up to 3 months every year in India. And even when they are not here, they would be counted as a faculty in our institutions and universities. So this is going to do huge things. We are creating 1,000 such positions in India for the best, the top scientists in the world to come here and do business. There are many other programs, as I listed over here. You see that there's a national postdoctoral fellowship scheme. We want the best of our PhD students to live and work in India. Not because they don't have a permanent job, they should not just migrate away from there. So we create the right infrastructure and fellowships for them to stay here and work. Of course, women scientists have special problems, break in career, relocation, and so on. And there are very good schemes which are launched to address these problems. Also to train women scientists, for example, in managing intellectual property. Also training women scientists in entrepreneurship. And we have several incubators for just women innovators. Actually, 7 of them at the last count. We also support women universities. Now, to looking at solving problems, we're working on clean coal technologies because about 60% of power in the nation is produced by coal. So unless we get onto clean coal technology, while we cannot meet our COP21 obligations. Waste processing, there's a new program in plastic waste, in hospital waste, and in electronic waste. All of this can create new opportunities. Electric mobility, we are working with Department of Heavy Industries. Electric mobility is their flagship program. We provide all the R&D support which is required for electric mobility, climate change. Digital India, there are a whole lot of interesting, exciting things going on. I'll come to it in just about 2 seconds. There's a new program on science and technology of yoga and meditation. which is to look at the deep scientific roots of our ancient practices, advanced manufacturing technologies for Make in India. We also have to be ready for the future, and this is one of the jobs of Department of Science and Technology, to look at the future, to see what is on the horizon 5 years from now, 10 years from now, what kind of challenges are coming in. There's a new technology roadmap 2035 that has been released by TIFEC, and there are also sector-wise reports, very interesting. So if you look at materials, manufacturing, ICT, medical science, transportation, going in the future, what would be our challenges, what would be the opportunities, how do we meet these opportunities, all of that is over there. These reports are available on the web, TIFEC, really a treasure house of very interesting stories. To give you one example, a major threat to our jobs, to our manufacturing, to our services would come from the rise of intelligent machines. IoT, Internet of Things, from big data, from artificial intelligence, robotics, smart sensors, quantum computing, and so on, we are meeting this challenge head on. Not just R&D, but to have manpower trained in these very important areas, to have innovations, technology development, to have incubators, to have industry support. So developing cyber-physical systems as an entire ecosystem. And this is going to be the most important, the single most important science and technology challenge that the society would face in the coming years. So we have to be ready for it. And to just give you an example, stuff which has already been going on, national supercomputing missions would set up 6 supercomputers this year. There is making new, a very good example of public-private partnership with Intel, making these very small sensors for air and water quality, throw them in thousands, they communicate through satellite, provide big data real time, so that all the communities can actually take decisions based on this data. Smart grids for power is the requirement. We know that generation of power is not a bottleneck. It is the transmission and distribution which are the bottlenecks. And in order to address that problem, what one needs to do is develop what is called smart grids and microgrids for those communities which are not on grid, which are off-grid communities. Give you an example, there are also very strong connects with international community in this area. Just last year, we signed a new agreement with Israel in cyberspace and water and agriculture, and with Japan with Internet of Things and big data. There are going to be new large-scale initiatives launched this year, as suggested by the group of secretaries. So these are the big initiatives that would be launched by Department of Science and Technology. The first one I already talked about. Vigyan Jyoti is a special effort to bring women and girls into science and technology, not just to bring them in, but get them into areas where there is a huge underrepresentation, for example, in IITs, for example, in technology. We need to create future leaders, need to create role models. So this is actually a seamless program which will go from high school all the way to the top end, not just in academics, but also in innovation, in incubation, in a whole lot of different things that women ought to be participating in very strongly. Is enabling. It's not about reservations. It's about creating a level playing field. So if we just remove the problems, the special problem that girls and women face, we make a level playing field, then everything is going to happen on its own. Vigyan Prasar is to reach out to society at large, to all stakeholders of science and technology by various means, through a technology, science and technology portal. We are going to create a new channel, internet channel, TV channel, and so on. Accelerate Vigyan, I would stop with that, this is the last point. Accelerate Vigyan is about, we have a huge science and technology infrastructure in the country. About 20,000 crores of it is added every year, whether in academia, in R&D labs, and so on. But the maintenance and effective use of that infrastructure is very important. This particular scheme is going to ensure that we create large number of people who are trained in that infrastructure so that we can not only use it efficiently, effectively, but also maintain it and not be dependent on foreign countries to do that. Okay, so while I'm going to run through many interesting, important things that happened last year, there was a remote activation of Devasthal telescope, which is 3.2 meter optical telescope in Nainital, is the best telescope in Asia. Just give you random samples of some of the stuff which happened. The Science Express, many of you know about it, it made 6 new LIMCA Book of Records just this year. And this has been possible because we made a lot of changes in the way this program is run. One of the world records come on the way of Science Express this year. More details can be found. This is fresh from the press. I received this 2 days ago. So very exciting story indeed. We made new technologies for rural areas. This is a very good example of a relevant technology for rural areas that uses local resources, meets local needs, and generates local skills. Here, you use agricultural waste to make electricity, but also to make distilled water, but also create cold storage facilities, which are so much required in rural areas to preserve our agricultural produce. Microsolar dome, there are about 1 crore households in India which are considered to be off-grid or brownout, right, receive very little electricity. This is a very strong solution, cost only 1,000 rupees, and while it provides light both during the day and in the night, really very, very interesting thing. We are going to take it, we're going to produce the first 1 lakh units this year, and after that it would be scaled up with the help of many other ministries and schemes of the government. I ought to really stop here. Very interesting, this model in fact is being displayed outside, so I would not spend time on it, except to say that we create cyber-physically our important monuments in the country, and you can take a virtual walk through there. Look at the 3D printed actual stuff, but also you can take a virtual walk, you can define your walk, so you don't need to visit everywhere. Right there in Delhi, you can visit, do Bharat Darshan. Clean energy research has produced many successes. Clean energy research, the water initiatives, which go all the way from conservation to utilization to purification. It's not just about purification. You need large-scale concepts to conserve water, to utilize water, and so on. And so, that's my last slide. Essentially, leave with the message that science and technology is not only about high-end science, high technology, but it reaches out to people at every level. And indeed, Department of Science and Technology is fully committed to doing that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Asutosh Sharma. Now I request this, the last presentation of this press conference, Dr. M. Rajivan, Secretary, Earth Sciences, to make his presentation. After that, the Honorable Minister will address you, then we'll take some questions.
Good afternoon. I am very happy to present the key initiatives and achievements made by Ministry of Earth Sciences for the last 3 years, 2014-17. Next one. As you know that the mandate of the ministry is to provide weather, climate, ocean services, and also to survey ocean resources and technology development for ocean technology, and also do the seismological services for sample earthquake detection and information. And we also explore 3 poles, both Arctic, Antarctic, as well as Himalayas, and do scientific explorations. The next slide. As far as weather service is concerned, as you may be knowing that our forecast substantial improvement in weather forecast as well as warnings, especially 2 important items is heavy rainfall as well as tropical cyclones. And the recent cyclones I can mention is tropical cyclone Phailin, Hudhud, and Vardha, in which we had minimal loss of human lives. You may be remembering the 99 cyclone at Orissa, it killed about 10,000 people. The same Indian cyclone like Phailin, which crossed the same coast of Orissa, which killed only less than 10 people. So the improvement in cyclone forecast has been an important achievement by the Ministry of Earth Sciences. And as for similarly, we have achieved skillful forecast for heavy rainfall up to 3 days. And in advance, the recent Chennai flood forecast also was a good example to cite. And last year, we introduced the heat wave forecast for the first time. That, as you know, that many people died due to heat waves during April, May, June season. And so I'll describe a little more later. And we also has launched an outcasting system of predicting rainfall as well as thunderstorms and lightning using the Doppler radar network. And Delhi, using Doppler radar at Delhi, we also launched a special outcasting scheme for Delhi region. And these are all we could achieve because we augmented our observational network and we did a lot of research in modeling, especially improvement in data simulation. We bought high-performance computers because for all this research, we need high-performance computers. We also then we did training of our scientific personnel. We sent our young scientists abroad, especially US and UK, and we got them trained for doing excellent modeling work. Next slide. This is the recent tropical cyclone Vardha, in which we could predict almost 3.5 days in advance that where it will be crossing the land. And as I told, that loss of life during the last 3 years due to tropical cyclone has reduced less than 100 as compared to the thousands of life being lost in the previous decade. Next slide, please. This is a forecast of heat wave. As I told, that heat wave is one of the severe weather events which caused many casualties in the country. Last year, about 2,500 people died. And we launched both the seasonal forecast as well as extended range forecast as well as medium range forecast for heat wave. And based on our forecast, 4 states, Gujarat, Andhra Pradesh, Maharashtra, and Orissa, have instituted state action plans. And so they closely work with us. And once we issue a forecast, they immediately do kind of an action, proactive role they make. And they also tie up with their own health department to take care of the people. And in continuation of that, our Honorable Mandriji has recently written to all other remaining states, like, for example, Uttar Pradesh, Rajasthan, and Bihar, chief ministers to start this kind of state action plans, and Bihar has already come up with another new initiative of state action plan for Bihar. So this has been a successful forecast which we introduced recently. Next one, please. So our flagship program for Ministry of Earth Science is basically giving agrometeorological services to the farmers. We provide nowcast, 5-day forecast, then also we give now 15 to 20-day forecast basically for their planning and day-to-day planning. At present, we give district-level forecast through 130 agromet field units. And if you really see the NCR report of the recent one, 50,000 crore benefits. And our forecast reached to 21 million farmers through SMS. And in 2014, it was just 7 million. So threefold increase in reaching to people. And by end of this year, this will come around 32, 33 million farmers. And we, as you know, that the farmers need forecast at a very, very high resolution. And at present, as I told, we are giving only district level. We are going to launch block level forecast by 2019. And to start with, we will start with 100 block levels forecast by this year. And this will be in association with, in a close collaboration with ICAR. They have Krishi Vigyan Kendras at each districts. So we will be setting up our district centers at each 660 districts, and we will be catering the forecast weather services for farmers at each blocks. See, about 6,600 blocks. For that, we need a very high resolution weather forecast model. So we have already developed a 12-kilometer model and introduced, and we are generating operational forecast using this 12-kilometer model at block-level weather forecast. So with this skill, we are almost equal to U.S. Weather Services. They also provide the weather forecast at 12-kilometer. And for that, we need to improve the high-performance computing. We have at present 1.2 petaflop machine, which is second best in the country. But we are going to procure the 10 petaflop machine by November 2017. Already order has been placed with the Cray computers. And if everything goes well, we will get the 10 petaflop machine. That will be one of the best in the world for computing. Next slide. Climate services, as you know, the monsoon prediction is important because monsoon is very important for national economy as well as GDP. We have recently, 2012, we launched a program called National Monsoon Mission of the 400 crore. And using this, under this monsoon mission, we have developed an indigenous dynamical prediction system for monsoon with all time scale from short range, medium, and as well as seasonal forecast. This year, we issued the seasonal forecast for 2017 monsoon based on this dynamical model. And we'll be coming out with the next second level forecast in first week of June, maybe on 5th or 6th of June, using the same dynamical prediction system that has been an important achievement under the monsoon mission. And 2015 was a drought year. We could predict this drought very successfully so that the agriculture ministry, for example, could take a lot of proactive role and mitigate the drought situation. And also we do a lot of science of climate change. We don't involve in policy of science of climate change because that is the mandate of Ministry of Environment for us. But we do the basic science of climate change, why climate change is happening, and also making projections for the future climate. So we are already started developing air system model. Already a first version of air system model is already available at the Institute at Pune. And for the first time, IPCC reports, our model will be participating. So far, our fifth report, up to five reports, no Indian model was participating. We did not have an earth system model. For the first time, the sixth report, which will be coming out in 2019, we will be participating. Our inputs will be going into the IPCC reports. The next one. The Oceanic Services, of course, under Weather and Climate Services, we are also launching many new programs, which I would like to mention is, one is a multi-hazard warning system for heavy rainfall and flash floods, and including lightning and thunderstorm. We have going to launch an atmospheric chemistry program on air pollution, basically, also urban meteorology. And we have sanctioned for buying a research aircraft, which we'll be buying it by this year. And that will be used for doing experiment for cloud seeding and artificial rain making. And the Oceanic Services, our important activity is marine fishery advisory services through the Indian coast, both east and west coast. And it's called potential fishery zones advisories based on satellite data of SST and chlorophyll to find abundant fish. So that has been very successful program last 5-6 years. And currently it reaches about 2.5 lakh fishermen, and it was in 2014 it was just 1.505 lakh. And NCR report says that fishermen save about 3,000 crore per year by making use of this potential fishery zone advisory from us. And the second one is the regional tsunami warning system. You know that after the famous 2004 tsunami, the great tsunami, we have set up this system at Hyderabad Institute. And that is going very well. And we are not only catering to Indian region, but also we are catering to other countries like South Asia, as well as we are going to launch the tsunami warning system for Southeast now. And if everything goes well, we may also plan for a tsunami warning system for South China Sea in future. And the highlight of the tsunami warning system so far was no false alarm. We have been issuing tsunami warning system forecast, but no false alarm so far. The false alarms are very tricky because we have to involve a lot of work, because we have to really literally move people. So far, no false alarm was issued. This has been successful. The next one, please. And also, we provide ocean state forecast, especially the waves as well as the disaster weather over the Indian seas. And many users, including Indian Navy as well as Coast Guard, is using our forecast. And currently about 16.5 lakh users are using it. In 2014, it was just 7.67. So the number is going up. And also we got a lot of economic benefits as per the NCAR report. And two new initiatives which we have taken up only last year is, one is prediction of oil spill trajectory. We have developed a scheme for predicting how once an oil spill is happening, then how it will move along the sea coast. And recently, the Chennai oil spill, we could give that oil spill trajectory to the state of Tamil Nadu. And also, we developed another tool for search and rescue operations, which was also well received and used by Indian Coast Guard recently. Next one, please. This is the ocean technology. As you know, the ocean contains a lot of minerals, so we have an agreement with the international authority called International Seabed Authority. It's a UN body. And they have, 10 years back, they have given an agreement with us. And in that, we can really explore the polymetallic nodules lying under the Central Indian Ocean. In continuation of that, recently we signed an agreement with them for a 15 years contract for exploring hydrothermal sulfides, which also contains a lot of minerals. Very important metals. And we have been given an allotted area about 10,000 square kilometers over Central Indian Ocean. So we'll be developing now technology to explore these minerals. And in connection with, we already developed a few technology, for example, deep ocean mining system components, remotely operated vehicle which can go up to 6 kilometers down and take photographs or do some experiments. We have also developed unmanned submersibles. We have developed autonomous coring system, in-situ soil tester, also bottom pressure recorder. So we'll be further doing these experiments and developing further technology. The next two important technology development will be a manned submersible, which can literally take three people down 6 kilometers. And also, at this time, we have the capability of monitoring and informing people within 5 minutes of earthquake occurrence. And so that we have to increase our seismological network in the country so that it can be reduced to 3 minutes. Within 3 minutes, we will be able to inform the concerned authorities about the occurrence of the earthquake. So that we are, by end of this year, the seismological observatories will be increased to 116. And we also taken up a few cities like Delhi, Ahmedabad, Bangalore, and Calcutta for micro-solarization. And now 30 more cities have been identified, and a new proposal has been approved, and we'll be launching this 30 more cities by this year. And it will take about 2 years to complete this work. And to understand the earthquake process, we have recently launched a big experiment at Koyna, near Koyna Dam in Maharashtra, in which we want to drill about 3 kilometer holes and put the instruments and measure how the earthquake processes are happening. And already the first drilling has started, and now almost reached up to 2.9 kilometer. If some of you want to see that kind of experiments, we'll be happy to facilitate you to visit that place and see the experiment which we are doing at there. And next slide, please. And also, as I told that, we are also exploring polar regions, both Arctic, Antarctic, and also Himalayas, three poles. And Antarctica, as you know that we are the party in the Antarctic Treaty from 82 onwards, and we have been going there from 82. We have two stations there. Last year, we did a very important campaign called it MADIS, so with collaboration with Norwegian scientists, and from November 2016 to January 2017, which we used to understand ice dynamics and mass balance. And there are two new initiatives will be, one will be, we'll be procuring a polar research vessel, which we can literally take people from here to Antarctica. We don't have a polar research vessel. We normally hire ships. No, we have to have our own ship, so we'll be buying a ship. Already cabinet approval has been obtained. So we'll be floating the tender by this year. And also the Maitri station, which is one of the very old station at Antarctica, will be replaced. So it will need, we need another 3 years to develop a new station, which also we'll be doing it immediately. The Arctic, we know that Arctic also important because especially sea ice is declining. We have climate linkages with the Arctic. So we are an observer status. We have an observer status in the Arctic Council. We have a station called Himadri. We will be taking measurements there for very summer season. And there we have plans for expansion up to some more stations there. In the Himalayan glaciers, as you know, the glaciers are melting and some glaciers are retreating. So we need to really understand the Himalayan glacier system, cryosphere system. So we have recently launched, last year we have set up a station called Himansh at about 4,000 meter height at Himalayas. And we will be doing more scientific experiments on understanding Himalayan glaciers. Next one, please. And last year we had the group of secretaries, we recommended, we made many recommendations, and based on that we identified new department action plans. One is the farmer-centric initiatives, and in which we will be strengthening our agrometeorological services, and employment opportunities. We are going to help tourism industries by providing customized forecast for tourism, and under accelerated growth or blue economy, we will be developing an ocean thermal energy conversion plant at Kavaretti. Already work has started. So as we know that desalination, three plants have been already established by our ministry in Lakshadweep Islands, but these plants are run by diesel generators. So the new initiative will be from ocean thermal energy, we'll be generating electricity that will be used to run the desalination plant. So that will be the new initiative. First time we will be doing that. We also try to do a project called Marine Observing System along the Indian coast to understand the marine pollution. So pollution is not only over the inland, it also is very important for marine coast along the east and west coast. So we need to understand, so we need to establish Marine Observing System. Next one. And recent secretary, group of secretaries meeting, we have made a beautiful recommendation called Deep Ocean Research. It will be truly an inter-ministerial program launched by, it will be led by Ministry of Earth Sciences, but all other scientific ministries like DPT, DST, CSIR, ISRO, DRDO, as well as Department of Energy will be involved. This proposal is being prepared now. Well, next month we have a brainstorm meeting being launched, and the basic proposed activities will be extraction of resources, energy, development of ocean technology, understanding of geo-hazards. As you know, the 2004 tsunami, it really started at the bottom of the sea. So we need to understand earthquakes and volcanoes under the bottom of the sea, and exploration of marine genetic resources, etc. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. M. Rajivanji. Now, friends, the Honorable Minister will address you all.
Good afternoon, friends. Thank you so much for all your patience. You must be wondering why we thought of making these presentations to you. But in spite of the fact that almost over an hour has been taken by the presentations, I would beg to say that this is just about the tip of the iceberg that the Science and Technology Ministry is actually doing. It's really a very, very Herculean task. It was very, very difficult for us to actually shortlist what we should be talking to you and what we should put in the book and what we should just keep away from the book, because we can't improve the size of the book to unlimited extent. And you have to really go and see all this all over the country to believe what I am saying. 2014, when we came to power, before that science and technology was a very, very important component of our manifesto. And our vision was India innovates, India leads. I was assigned the responsibility of this ministry in 2014, November. And from the very next week, I just started visiting the various laboratories in the country, started having interactions with the scientists, seeing what they do, what is the state of equipments, what is the status of research, what is our potential, what is our capability, what actually we have achieved. And I was thoroughly convinced that our scientists in silos are actually producing excellence. But when I would look at the larger picture, I thought and I concluded that probably the sum total of what they were doing in parts was always less than the whole. And that is why we initiated this basic movement, where we thought that probably the need of the hour was a good quality synergy, and a good quality synergy and a shared purpose for India, and a spirit to work together, work with optimal utilization, optimal coordination, optimal energies, and a clear-cut vision. And that is what I would say is our singular most achievement of the last 3 years, which has put the whole scientific community of India on one platform, thinking in unison with their heart and soul into their scientific activity, with a dream to take India to the top with the help of science and technology. Even at the cost of repetition, I would say that you have also heard from my colleagues that in terms of the development of scientific research, and which is manifested by its publications, the international growth rate is about 4% now, but our Indian growth rate is 13% right now. And this itself is an indicator of the type of scientific activity and its growth that we are seeing all over India, of course inspired by the vision of our Honorable Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi ji. CSIR, one of our most premier institutions, as you have heard just now, to achieve a status of being 12th all over the world amongst 1,200 institutions which are in the government sector, and then to achieve a status of being amongst the first 100 in over 5,000 institutions all over the world, this is something really remarkable. In a short span of time, we have now become the sixth country in the world with maximum number of publications, and in another 2 years from now, you will see that we'll be around fourth or fifth. And in nanotechnology itself, we have become third in the whole world. This is just a brief about these technical things. Of course, it has been mentioned by my secretary that the commitment of the government towards science is well manifested in the fact that we had quite a significant enhancement in our budget for the last 3 years, and then for the next year also, which is quite significant. Another important thing that, and then of course to encourage and provide better avenues for our scientists and young researchers, fellows, I think it was hardly a few months later that we came to power, we enhanced their fellowship by over 50%. Then the major thrust of our activities, as was told earlier, was that we have tried to take science out of the four walls of the laboratory and connect it with the people, and more particularly with the people and their problems, and also more particularly with the problems of the poorest of the poor and the rural people. And that is where we have ensured and assured, and actually done it in the last 3 years, is that we have aligned science now to all our national priorities. And this can be manifested, this can be seen if you analyze the whole presentations in detail, you'll find that we have aligned the focus and the discovery direction of science to ensure that the problems and the sufferings related to the people of the fields, for virtually every field which is a national priority, whether it is health, whether it is energy, whether it is water, whether it is transport, whether it is agriculture, where we are focus is about improving the lives of the farmers, that's the mission of the Prime Minister also, manufacturing, water processing, digital empowerment, skill development, innovation, and inclusive grassroots development, environment and climate, disaster management and mitigation, and of course all the strategic sectors. We have tried our best to ensure that the divide between the rural and the urban is bridged to the maximum possible extent. Apart from this overall national priorities, looking at fundamental science, and then of course ensuring that all these national missions, all these programs that the Prime Minister started, whether it's a Digital India or whether it was the Swasth Bharat, Samast Bharat, Samarth Bharat, Swachh Bharat, Smart Cities. In all these programs, the science and technology in a very focused manner is trying to strengthen those programs, and ensuring that science and technology helps in the successful realization of the dreams for all these programs. This is one side of the aspect. On the other side, we can say that it's not only the fundamental thing, but even for the high-ended science, we have done quite well, significantly well, by the examples that you have seen, the National Supercomputing Mission, which was passed by our cabinet, and already in this year you'll have 6 big computers installed, and it's a huge mission which is going to be accomplished in the next few years. A National Monsoon Mission has been launched, which is about 400 crores. Now, within 12 kilometers up to the block level, we intend to provide those agromet services to the farmers, and which already, with the 21 million farmers being given those provided those agromet services, is producing a positive impact in GDP worth about 50,000 crores. And now we are going to reach up to the block level. This is another big thing. You know about the LIGO thing, the observatory that we have for the gravitational waves. These are all international things we are doing together. The 30-meter telescope. The secretary just mentioned about our ensuing deep ocean mission, where we are going to work on finding out new sources of energy in the ocean, whether it is through the gas hydrates or the waves or the searching for the polymetallic nodules, etc., etc. Then there was a mention made about the cyber physical system mission, which is also very, very important. The big data analytics, artificial intelligence, robotics, Internet of Things. In fact, I mentioned about this, that this is not only the fundamental research or the things related to the people about which so much of mention was made here, but, which was a very small description of many things that, in fact, CSIR right now is working on over 140, you can say, inventions, discoveries, where we are going to help the people solve many of their problems, and most of these things are in their advanced stages. There is hardly any time to talk about them, but we can, whenever those who are interested, they can have an information about them. Then, in fact, I want to mention that we have made all this highly inclusive, in the sense that whether it is a rural area, whether it is a poor man, whether it is a farmer, whether it is a child, whether it is the people in the Northeast, through the this National Innovation Foundation, people in the tribal areas, virtually everybody, we have ensured that it is connected with science. You know, recently we through the Survey of India, which is a 250-year-old organization, we made for the first time for every countryman, we made that every map, which was not accessible to an average countryman through routine methods, we made it accessible to average countrymen. So we have in fact ensured that science becomes thoroughly inclusive for everyone to participate in it. Then there was a mention about this biopharma mission, which is one of our very, very prestigious projects, which has been developed out of our biotechnology strategy vision paper, that was a vision document that was released to all of you, before all of you in 2015. And recently this is a 1500 crore project, where we are going to ensure that for development of biotechnology, biopharma, vaccines, all the cutting edge research, there is a joint facility of the state of art level created within the country, and where there is a synergy between all the stakeholders and all the players. For the first time, we have ensured in this country that whether it is a scientist in the laboratory, whether it is a man in the industry, whether it is anyone in the university, whether it is a research going on in the IITs, we have ensured that all of them are working at the same wavelength. In our brainstorming meetings also, We involve the IIT people also, we involve the ICERS also, we involve all those who are relevant in these situations. And friends, in fact, then to talk to you about the international collaborations. Right now, you will be very happy to know, I can say for sure, you see, I would not have said this 3 years back when I had not seen science from inside. Science inside the country from inside and science outside the country from inside. Now I have seen both from inside. And now I have participated in number of activities which are part of the international collaborations. So as you know, right now we have collaboration with almost 80 countries, out of which 44 countries are very, very active collaborations. And in all these collaborations, we basically work, the approach has changed. Our approach now is that we work on their strengths and our needs. That is the collaboration. And whether I talk to the American counterparts in White House, or whether I talk to them in Germany, whether I talk to them in South Korea, whether I talk to them in Japan, or whether I talk to them in UK, I find everywhere in those discussions and in the subjects that we exchange that we are inferior to none. We are maybe in many fields, like it is just now it was mentioned about the weather forecasting, early tsunami things, the earthquake warnings and the earthquake observations, the type of research that has happened in these fields. We have become world class. And maybe at some points and some sections of this, we are better than the others. Can you imagine in a place like Koyna in Maharashtra, our scientists have gone 3.5 kilometers drilling and putting sensors to ensure that we have continuous observations about earthquakes which happen there in a lot of frequency. And then in Shillong, we are working on measuring pressure and densities not only in the atmosphere but also in the ionosphere and the magnetosphere. This is the level of research, and then the ocean studies and the effect that is producing, that it is producing on the overall GDP. The synergies that we have just now mentioned have certainly produced a lot of positive activities in the field of startup ecosystem, which I can say with surety that what had been achieved in the last 30 years in the startup ecosystem, probably we have achieved better than that in the last 3 years itself, and we may be doubling that in the next 2, 3, 4 years. Our budget for startup movement and the stand-up movement in science and technology itself has gone up to 400-500%. And we have created great synergies for ensuring that all our people, all our scientists, CSIR, biotechnology, earth sciences, everyone else outside, they ensure that through the research in science, we ensure that by 2022, we are able to improve the income of the farmers, make it double. And for that, everyone is contributing, whether it is through a disease-resistant variety, or whether it is through a drought-resistant variety, or whether it is through a ashwagandha plantation in Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh in dry areas, or whether it is through the aroma mission, or whether it is through producing a small tractor for even the poorest of the poor farmer, etc., etc. And the same is true for the health, where the synergies of all the sectors, including health, ICMR, department, biotechnology, we are producing new drugs, new medical devices, affordable devices. We are producing new vaccines. Mention was made about the rotavirus, and then, of course, dengue, malaria, they are all in the offing. So this MedTech thing, this is all happening in a big way through synergies. And then there was this about this human resource development. There is a very, very active collaboration with the Ministry of Human Resource Development through the imprint program, and then the various other programs where we are in the future also we are going to train something like 1 lakh scientists all over the country to deliver the new India by 2022. This is another. And then a mention was already made, which I want to repeat even at the cost of repetition, that over 1,000 scientists have returned back to India in the last 2-3 years, because they find that the situation has drastically improved. There is more of positive atmosphere, and the schemes like Vajra have been mentioned, schemes like Manas have been mentioned, Manak have been mentioned for developing this, strengthening this innovation ecosystem, etc. And then, of course, the synergy in the energy field. You know, a lot of our scientists, they are working in ensuring that for the solar energy. If you just heard about the Surya Jyoti, very soon you will hear about the solar ATMs. We made a demonstration of it in our Calcutta review meeting, which is in an advanced stage of its discovery. And then, of course, the solar tree. You already know that the price of the solar energy has come down to 2.5 rupees. We are determined that to realize and help in ensuring that the vision of the Prime Minister for having that 175 gigawatt of clean energy that is realized in the next couple of years. So it is, in fact, there are a number of things. One more thing I wish to mention, that in the last 2-3 years, what we have ensured that now our scientists have access to the best facilities, which are like million-dollar facilities, which are created all over the world. There's the beam lines, the CERN near Geneva, the synchrotron facility in Japan, Germany, UK, France, all these FAIR 30-meter telescope. All these are missions in which our scientists in India have access. They can go there, they can work there, they can do their research, they can come back. So that is the level of participation that we have improved in these multi-billion facilities created all over the world. There are many, many things that I can talk about, but I think as I would request you to go through this book also. I know it requires a lot of patience to read such a big book. There is another book that I have ensured that it is part of your bag, which is a summary account of my experiences, and after having finished visiting almost every laboratory of the country, we have got that book produced, which will give you a fair amount of idea of what the scientists all over the country are doing, even in far off places, in labs which are established 50 years, 60 years back. So, and then of course there is a pen drive also, which I would request you to find out time to go through that. And our request would be that if you objectively feel that science has done something really and remarkably good for India in the last 2-3 years, please find some time for us and please find some space for us. I know that space is not in your hand, because most of the science journalists, they come and tell me, saab, hum to aapke paas aate hain, aapki press conference mein sari baat sunte hain, bahut achhi bhi lagti hai. स्टोरी भी बहुत अच्छी बना के देते हैं, लेकिन जब जाते हैं तो हमारे अखबार के अंदर जो है उसको छापने के लिए कोई जगह नहीं देता है. सो थ्रू यू एंड थ्रू द मीडिया पीपल वी रिक्वेस्ट द सीनियर्स आल्सो इन द मीडिया टू प्लीज गिव सिग्निफिकेंट अमाउंट ऑफ स्पेस टू साइंस, बिकॉज साइंस इज द वन डिपार्टमेंट विच इज गोइंग टू चेंज द फॉर्चून्स ऑफ दिस कंट्री, एंड वी हैव द कॉन्फिडेंस एंड द एबिलिटी एंड द पोटेंशियल टू सॉल्व, help and alleviate the long-standing sufferings of the common man of India, which they continue to suffer even after 60 years of independence. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you, Honorable Minister, sir, for your inspiring address indeed. So now we will take questions. So you raise the hand first, we will go there. Yeah.
You mentioned about 1,000 scientists that have returned to India. So could you please elaborate on this?
You see, we have scholarships like the Ramanujan and Ramalinga Swami scholarships and fellowships, where there is we appeal to the scientific community of the whole world, and in fact you will find that this number is a very modest number. If you will go into the detail, and if you would like, you will find that there are more people who apply for that. For that also we have a selection process, and the selection is made by very senior, renowned people. It's not that anybody who wants to come to India, anybody who is worth and who we feel will be able to help India. So that this is just an indicator of the fact that people across the globe, they are feeling that the things are changing in India. India is now growing, India is now developing, India also has the state-of-the-art facilities, India also has the vision, India also has now the atmosphere where they can fulfill their ambitions. You see, the scheme may be there, but what I am trying to tell you that the from brain drain, now it has got converted to brain gain. This significant shift has started occurring in the recent times. And it's not that maybe scientists may be coming once in a while earlier also, but what I'm saying, there is a significant, it's not that what we have done is nothing was happening before that. After all, these laboratories were established at the time of independence by the great leaders of that time. But what we are trying to say that we have ensured that there is a production of positive synergy, and now the people are contributing that to that with their heart and soul, and this is what we have tried to push in the last 2-3 years with the leadership of Prime Minister.
Sir, Kushal from INS. I have two questions. First one is that how many patents were filed by CSIR labs in last 3 years, and how many of those patents have been licensed? Second question is, sir, that you said that we are inferior to none, and we had been covering the department for some time, and really good work has been done. Cutting edge technology has been produced, but still scientists feel that we are somewhere lagging in hardware, like Li-ion battery. When we talked about that, we are lagging behind in hardware. We're still dependent on countries like China or Taiwan. How long would it take to reduce or to end that kind of dependency, sir?
You see, as far as the number of patents, etc. is concerned, you will find the detailed account of everything in the book, because it's very difficult to remember the number of patents, because that is for every department, there is a within the department itself, there are 4 departments. You will find an account of that in case. You see, China may be better as compared to us in certain fields, but these fields like manufacturing and others, advanced manufacturing, these are the fields where I have given you an example. In nanotechnology, in recent times, we have grown to 3rd position in the world. It's not that in everything China is better than us. There are many things in which, but we now have the capacity, capability, and of course the energy to go to the top, and that is our ultimate goal. We are striving to go towards that direction, and we are confident that in the next few years, we should be on top of the whole world.
Yeah. Madam Ma.
You mentioned that the Earth Sciences Ministry is going to procure 2 vehicles. One is the aircraft for the cloud seeding, and the other is the polar research vehicle. By when should they be available, and especially with the cloud seeding one, which area are you planning to look at, and can you give more details about the polar research vehicle also?
This cloud seeding experiment will start this year, this summer, and already the place will be in Maharashtra, Solapur area, and we already got a C-band radar. It will be coming another 1 week, and this is that campaign will go for 3 more years. And the polar research vessel, this year we are floating tender. It takes about 3 years to 2.5 years to come, so it may take another 3 years to get the polar research vessel.
Yeah, please.
Dr. Harshvardhan, when you came into power, policy paralysis was the name of the game. In the last 3 years, both Dr. Vijayaraghavan and you have worked very hard on changing that, especially for genetically modified mustard. As science minister, you have pursued it very hard. Do you think the environment minister should clear genetically modified mustard?
You see, I think before we began this press conference, I said that today, you see, one day I will certainly answer this question. You see, I have just taken over the charge of the other ministry yesterday, just signed my papers, had an introduction. I have not even studied what is actually going on in that ministry, what is the opinion of the scientists there, etc., etc. So unless I study about the subject, and get, you know, I never shirk from answering anything, but I never answer unless I have studied the thing. So I will have to go and study, and I will certainly answer this question one day after I have thoroughly studied the subject. And today, as such, as a policy, we also decided that we will not answer anything apart from science and technology. With all respect and regards for you, please forgive me for not answering this question right now.
Yes, madam.
Dr. Harshvardhan, ji, you said the work on developing new vaccine and drugs against dengue was going on. So can you please tell how far are we away from finally having these anti-dengue vaccine or drugs?
I think for drugs and vaccines discoveries, it's very difficult to say how far. But I think we are, as far as dengue and this malaria thing is concerned, we are quite ahead in the research in that. And rotavirus is already introduced in the, rotavirus and some other vaccines are already introduced in the universal immunization program. Maybe Dr. Vijay Raghavan can further elaborate on that.
Thank you very much, Mantriji. As Mantriji says, you know, the outcomes are never predictable. These are, after all, trials. But both in dengue and malaria, we have gone beyond phase one trials. We are, the International Center for Genetic Engineering and Biotechnology has led both areas, and they are partnering with both industry and academia to take this ahead. We are also separately partnering through the US-India Vaccine Action Program on many vaccines. And thirdly, as I mentioned, both our own efforts in a biopharma mission will address specific vaccine preventable diseases, and the coalition of epidemic preparedness will take others. So yeah, the outcomes are difficult to predict, but we are doing extraordinary efforts.
Can I ask one more question?
I'll come back to you. Let others have a chance. Yes.
Minister Dinakar Peri from the Hindu. Again on the
Speak into the mic, please.
Dinakar Peri from the Hindu.
Can see you.
So again, question on the return of the scientists. So can you specify what areas or which sectors have they, you know, joined in, when they, the 1,000 plus who have come back? And can you give a breakup of per year if possible? Which sectors, which areas?
I think probably in all the areas, but we have not compiled, means as such, this statistics whether about the details of these scientists is right now not available with me. But I think in all the fields, wherever I have gone, I find that there is this talk. A new man has come, he has joined, he has come. So if you want, the department can give you detailed statistics about what are the areas or the qualifications of these scientists. But they are all well-meaning people, young, energetic people who have a great vision and who have great enthusiasm to serve the country.
Yes.
सर कई सालों से हम लोग कवर कर रहे हैं तो जितनी बातें आपने बताई ऑलमोस्ट हम लोगों को सब पता है अब अगले दो साल में आप क्या करेंगे उसके बारे में अगर कुछ बताइए कोई स्पेशल प्लान या कोई ऐसा कुछ है जो आप नेक्स्ट टू इयर्स के लिए आप लोगों ने प्लान किया है जो एक्स्ट्राऑर्डिनरी हो सकता है
देखिए अभी अभी जैसे हमने बात किया कि करीब यहाँ जो CSIR का प्रेजेंटेशन हुआ उसमें शायद आपके सामने दो चार पांच चीज़ें एग्जाम्पल के रूप में रखी गई कि कोई शीर स्कैनर बना दिया कोई ऐसी चीज़ बना दी लेकिन वास्तव में जो ऑलरेडी बना चुके हैं बनकर एस्टैब्लिश हो चुकी हैं ट्रांसलेट हो चुकी हैं इंडस्ट्री को आगे एक्शन के लिए पब्लिक तक पहुंचाने के लिए वो भी बहुत सारी हैं इसके अलावा जैसा मैंने कहा कि करीब 140 से ज़्यादा ऐसी अभी नंबर है अलग अलग तरीके से जिनके ऊपर विभिन्न स्तरों पर काम हो रहा है, एडवांस्ड काम हो रहा है, और उनको उनको हम लोग जो है एक एक साल पर रिव्यू करते हैं। जैसे अभी आपने देखा कि अभी हम लोगों ने कलकत्ता के अंदर और दिल्ली के अंदर और जो है दूसरे CSIR का अभी यहाँ पर नेशनल फिजिकल लेबॉरेटरी में सब जगह पे हम रिव्यू करते हैं। इसके पहले देहरादून में और फरीदाबाद में हमने एक साल डेढ़ साल पहले रिव्यू किया था। तो हम यानी चीज़ों को खाली ऐसा नहीं कि किसी ने कुछ भी करने के लिए मन में सोच लिया, चीज़ों की मॉनिटरिंग, टाइमलाइन, टारगेट्स, ये सारी चीज़ें भी मॉनिटर हो रही हैं। और ये प्रधानमंत्री जी ने भी हम लोगों को बार बार इस चीज़ के लिए, हमें इस सपने को पैदा करने के लिए कहा है कि लोगों के जो समस्याएं हैं उनका समाधान करने के लिए। फिर जो हाई एंडेड रिसर्च है उसकी भी बात हो रही है कि डीप ओशन के अंदर भी जो है लेटेस्ट किस्म की रिसर्च हो रही है, लीगो की ऑब्जर्वेटरी के बारे में ग्रेविटेशनल वेव्स पर भी काम हो रहा है, बीम लाइन्स पर भी जाकर लोग काम कर रहे हैं, नैनो टेक्नोलॉजी की भी गहराई के अंदर जा रहे हैं, उनके एप्लीकेशंस में भी जा रहे हैं। तो सभी तरह के काम हो रहे हैं। कोई दो साल में अभी जैसा हमने कहा कि 1,00,000 साइंटिस्ट को एक बहुत बड़े पैमाने पे हमें नई ऊर्जा के साथ जो है ट्रेन करना है। फिर जो हमारे CSIR के अंदर इतना बड़ा स्किल डेवलपमेंट का प्रोग्राम जो है हमने इनिशिएट किया है, जो पहली बार हुआ है कि जिसमें यंग लोग जिनको शायद उतनी अच्छी लंबी चौड़ी कोई फॉर्मल एजुकेशन भी बहुत ज़्यादा नहीं मिल पाई होगी, लेकिन उनको हम वहाँ ट्रेन कर रहे हैं और उनको साथ में इंडस्ट्री के लिए एसेट बनाने का काम कर रहे हैं। जिज्ञासा कार्यक्रम हमारा बहुत जल्दी हम लॉन्च करने वाले हैं अनदर फ्यू डेज, जिसके अंदर हम HRD मिनिस्ट्री के साथ जो उनके केंद्रीय विद्यालय के बच्चे हैं, वो बच्चे जो है अब पहली बार आप देखेंगे कि हमारी जो साइंस की लेबॉरेटरीज़ हैं उनके अंदर आकर दे विल बी, उनको वहाँ पर हम रहने का हफ्ते के लिए, दो हफ्ते के लिए वो लोग आएंगे, उसके अंदर आकर वो वहाँ पे हम उनको रहने का गेस्ट हाउस में अपने अरेंजमेंट्स करेंगे CSIR की साइंस की दूसरी लैब्स में, और वो बच्चे आकर लैब्स के अंदर आकर देखेंगे ताकि उनके मन में जो है, हम चाहते हैं कि जो साइंस के लिए फ्यूचर के लिए जो हमारे को साइंटिस्ट पैदा करने हैं, और उसके लिए जिज्ञासा के माध्यम से ये बच्चे जाकर डायरेक्टली देखेंगे। जो मानक वाला जो प्रोग्राम है उसमें 10 लाख नए आइडियाज़, यानी हर 5,00,000 स्कूलों के अंदर दो इनोवेटिव आइडियाज़ के ऊपर फोकस करके, पहले होता था कि वो बाज़ार में फैक्ट्री लगी होती थी वहाँ से मॉडल बना लेते थे और उसी पे ये कार्यक्रम चलता था, हमने उसका सारा जो टोटल प्रारूप है जो इंस्पायर कार्यक्रम का उसको चेंज कर दिया है। तो ये सारी चीज़ें ऑफकोर्स अगले दो साल की प्रायोरिटीज़ हैं। अभी जो बायोफार्मा मिशन की हमने बात की है, ये कटिंग एज रिसर्च जो है इसके बायोटेक के लिए, मेडटेक के लिए, वैक्सीन के लिए, ये सारा जो है अगले वर्षों के प्रोग्राम है।
या हाय सर, दिस इज तापोस फ्रॉम दूरदर्शन। सर, वी जस्ट सॉ अ मॉडल ऑफ यू नो डिजिटल रिकंस्ट्रक्शन ऑफ अ साइट फ्रॉम हम्पी। सो इज देयर अ प्लान टू हैव मोर ऑफ दोज इन द फ्यूचर?
Yes, I forgot to mention about it. This is one of our very, very ambitious and very, very important projects for which you have seen this. We have already done it for Hampi, and now in the next few weeks or few months from now, you will see that we are going to do it for many other places like Taj or maybe the Ghats in Varanasi, etc., etc. So it's going to be multiplied, and already we are working in close collaboration or understanding with the culture ministry also. We are trying to take it up with them also. So, but we have provided the shape to this program, and this is a very, very passionate activity of our department.
Yeah. That gentleman.
Sir, Ravindra Desai. Sir, I just want to ask a question about those students who has done their PhD from abroad and now they are back without doing their postdoctoral fellowships. But here, after coming back, they are not in this position to find any laboratory, no labs, especially in the NIIs and Department of Biotechnology. They are not allowing them to work with them because all they are filled up. And these students are not in this position to find a postdoctoral fellowship anywhere. They came back for the service of the nation, but now they are in a fix.
You see, if you have any specific cases or instances, please let our department. You see, as far as we are concerned, we are trying to help the scientific community, young and experienced in all forms. And there are so many scholarships of various natures which are available for the students at various levels and even for the postdoctoral fellows. A list of those scholarships is mentioned in this book also. It's mentioned on our website also. Someone has to apply. But of course, in science, there is always a scientific mechanism of selection also, where you have to actually, you cannot compromise on quality. But I don't know what is the exact problem of these people. If you let us understand and know any of these fellows, please send them to us. We'll find out.
Last row, please.
Dr. Saab, I've seen a very good presentation. Your leadership, your ministry is doing a very good job. You know, you're a doctor. In the Purvi Uttar Pradesh, with Japanese encephalitis, with the Purvi Uttar Pradesh, 12 states are affected. So, there, what you know, I've never known yet that this is from which virus. And from China, a vaccine was asked. और क्या आपके एजेंडे में है कि वहाँ पे यहाँ से वैक्सीन बनाई तो वहाँ लगवाया जाए लोगों को, उसे राहत दिलवाई जाए?
जो उसकी वैक्सीन है वो तो हमारे डिपार्टमेंट का ही डेवलपमेंट है. और मैं आपको अपना व्यक्तिगत अनुभव से बता सकता हूँ, क्योंकि मैंने भी 6 महीना उधर हेल्थ मिनिस्ट्री में भी काम किया. मैं स्वयं बिहार में और ईस्टर्न यूपी के उन सब इलाकों में जाके 3 रात वहाँ रुका था. मैंने सब बच्चों के केसेस वगैरह स्टडी किए. उसके ऊपर बहुत एडवांस्ड में रिसर्च चल रही है, और जो सीडीसी अटलांटा के साथ भी कोलैबोरेशन में रिसर्च चल रही है, क्योंकि उसके बारे में कई तरह के व्यूज़ हैं कि क्या उसका कॉज जो है वो टॉक्सिक है, उसका कॉज मेटाबॉलिक है, उसका कॉज कोई इन्फेक्शन है. और उसमें जो रिसर्च का काम है वो बहुत गहराई से चल रहा है, और हम ये समझते हैं कि ये अत्यंत संवेदनशील विषय है. लेकिन जो रिसर्च होता ही है उसकी एक अपनी तरीका होता है, उसके अपने पैरामीटर्स, उसके नॉर्म्स होते हैं. रिसर्च में ऐसा नहीं होता कि हमने बटन दबाया दूसरी तरफ से उसका रिसर्च का रिजल्ट निकल जाए. बट मैं इतना बता सकता हूँ जितना मुझे संज्ञान में है कि उसके ऊपर हमारे देश के अंदर जो है गंभीरता से जो रिसर्च की दृष्टि से चिंता होनी है वो ऑलरेडी हो रही है.
So there was a mention about that cloud seeding project, but Kerala government, when they proposed a project, the central government has not given any permission for that. So what is the present status of that? Are you reconsider that, or that has been closed here? Here.
Yeah, he does the third.
Yeah. There was a mention about that cloud seeding project, and there was a specific project from Kerala, but that project has been denied, not from the central government. Will you reconsider, or that has been closed? What is the present situation of that?
See, we don't have an authority to say no to any state and cloud seeding. It is their prerogative, then they started doing it. And only thing they wanted our technical guidance from our institute, which we are providing. And I think I understand that they are going ahead with the cloud seeding experiment this monsoon season.
Yeah, please ask your question. That last fourth.
Hello. Haan, Madhurendra. सर, मेरा सवाल अर्थ साइंस से जुड़ा हुआ है. लगातार ये देखा जा रहा है पैटर्न 2014, 15, 16 और 17 ग्लोबल वार्मिंग का जो ट्रेंड है इंडिया में, खासतौर पे महानगरों में, अब वो लगातार बढ़ता जा रहा है. जो रिकॉर्डेड टेम्परेचर्स हैं अब वो पिछले सारे रिकॉर्ड्स को तोड़ रहे हैं. दूसरी तरफ ये देखा जा रहा है कि जो भी बर्फ है वो भी लगातार पिघलती जा रही है. कोई स्टडी आपके डिपार्टमेंट ने की हो कि ग्लोबल वार्मिंग का जो ट्रेंड है उसको लेकर भारत में प्रमुख जिम्मेदारियाँ क्या हैं, और किस तरह से इससे निपटने के इंतजाम किए जा सकते हैं? मॉनसून पर भी इसका कोई असर की स्टडी हो अगर?
एक तो देखिए, जो पिछले साल से हमारे डिपार्टमेंट ने पहली बार सफलतापूर्वक हीट वेव्स के संदर्भ में भी प्रेडिक्शंस करने प्रारंभ किए हैं, और अभी हम जो संबंधित सरकारों को भी पहले से आगाह करते हैं, उनको भी हीट वेव्स को हैंडल करने के लिए प्लान्स वगैरह बनाने के लिए कहते हैं. हमारे जो साइंस एंड टेक्नोलॉजी में भी और दूसरी जगह पर भी, जो अर्थ साइंसेज में भी, इसके क्लाइमेट चेंज के कॉजेज के संदर्भ में बकायदा एक्टिवली रिसर्च हो रही है. और जो पेरिस का जो सम्मेलन हुआ था उसमें इंटरनेशनल लेवल पर भी क्लाइमेट चेंज की रिसर्च का एक सिग्निफिकेंट कंपोनेंट जो है उसकी जिम्मेदारी भारत के अंदर हमारे साइंस एंड टेक्नोलॉजी डिपार्टमेंट के पास है. तो इस संदर्भ में बहुत डिटेल में काम हो रहा है. उसकी डिटेल्स आप जानना चाहते हैं तो आप उसके संदर्भ में आशुतोष शर्मा जी से कभी भी बात कर सकते हैं, जो हमारे राजीवन जी हैं इनसे जानकारी ले सकते हैं.
वी कैन मेक दैट द लास्ट क्वेश्चन प्लीज.
डॉक्टर साहब नमस्कार, मैं ब्रजेश सिंह नवोदय टाइम से. मेरा सवाल यह है कि साइंस डिपार्टमेंट के रिसर्च अनुसंधान में हमारे लाखों वैज्ञानिक काम कर रहे हैं,
बरसों से एक धारणा है कि ये साइंटिस्ट जो आउटपुट दे रहे हैं, जितना हम उन पर इन्वेस्ट कर रहे हैं उस हिसाब से बहुत अच्छा नहीं हो रहा है। इंटरनेशनल मानक पर हमारे जो रिसर्च लेबोरेटरीज हैं उनके रिजल्ट्स अच्छे नहीं हैं। क्या वर्तमान गवर्नमेंट उनके आउटकम ऑडिट कराने का कोई प्लान है कि हमारे इंस्टीट्यूट किस तरह परफॉर्म कर रहे हैं? जब भी साइंस कांग्रेस होती है एक बात आती है कि हम दुनिया के बड़े देशों की तुलना में रिसर्च पे बहुत कम पैसा खर्च कर रहे हैं, लेकिन हम पा क्या रहे हैं उसके बारे में कोई बात नहीं होती।
देखिए, पहली बात तो ये कि जो जैसे आप बोल रहे हैं, मैं भी ऐसे ही बोलता था 3 साल पहले, क्योंकि मुझे जानकारी नहीं होती थी और मैंने कभी जो है गहराई से इसको विषय को समझा नहीं था, उसके जाके नज़दीक देखा नहीं था। साइंटिस्ट लोग कैसे काम करते हैं, क्या काम कर रहे हैं, उनकी लेबॉरेटरी में किस तरह के इक्विपमेंट है, हमने देखा नहीं था। दूसरी चीज़, आपने जो ऑडिट की बात की, जितनी हमने आपको बात बताया कि अभी हमारा दुनिया में क्या स्टेटस है, ये स्टेटस को हमने नहीं तय किया है। ये कोई मोदी जी की गवर्नमेंट ने ये तय नहीं किया है कि हमारा दुनिया के अंदर ये नंबर है। ये सारे इंटरनेशनल पैरामीटर्स पर इंटरनेशनल लोग तय करते हैं कि हम 12वें नंबर पे हैं कि 99वें नंबर पे हैं कि हम 6ठे नंबर पे हैं कि हम कहाँ पर हैं। तो मैं ये समझता हूँ कि थोड़ा सा आप अगर समय निकाल के आप हमें बताइए, जिस फील्ड में भी आपको लगता है कि इस फील्ड में साइंस में अच्छा काम नहीं हो रहा, हम उस फील्ड की जो अच्छी अच्छी लेबॉरेटरीज हैं उनमें आपके जाने का प्रबंध करेंगे। आप खुद देखिए, समझिए कि वहाँ वैज्ञानिकों ने क्या क्या किया है। ये तो मैं मान सकता हूँ कि साइंस में जितनी रिसर्च जो है, जिसके जो आउटकम्स हैं, उनको जनता तक पहुँचाने के बीच में गैप था जब हम 3 साल पहले आए। उस गैप को भी हमने काफ़ी भरने की कोशिश की है। अभी भी हमें लगता है इसके अंदर और स्ट्रेंथनिंग की ज़रूरत है कि इसका ट्रांसलेशन इन द इंटरेस्ट ऑफ द पीपल, ये कहीं ना कहीं हमारा थोड़ा सा कमज़ोर एरिया है। उसको भी हम प्रोफेशनल तरीके से, मैनेजेरियल स्किल्स से, जितने वेरियस स्टेक होल्डर्स हैं उनका इंक्लूसिव इन्वॉल्वमेंट करके हम उसको भी करने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं।
या फ्रेंड्स, वी विल कंक्लूड द प्रेस कॉन्फ्रेंस। आई थैंक द ऑनरेबल मिनिस्टर एंड मिनिस्टर ऑफ स्टेट फॉर देयर टाइम एंड प्रेजेंस हियर एंड ऑल द सेक्रेटरीज ऑन द डायस, एंड थैंक यू ऑल ऑल्सो। प्लीज जॉइन अस फॉर द लंच ऑन द 4th फ्लोर।